Let's start with today's session, which is the theoretical part about mastering CAN. First, what is IVNE, vehicle network? Guys, it describes how my ACUs are connected and how they link together. It's about the multiple ECUs and how they are interconnected within the car based on certain principles. For instance, some grouped electrical control units describe the powertrain, which relates to the brakes, the engine controller, the transmission controller that shifts between speeds. These are referred to as the car's powertrain dynamics, which are very crucial. There's also telematics. What does it cover? It deals with communications, whether it's video, mobile, radio, or the infotainment system. Like the fancy touchscreen, where you can connect to Bluetooth and play music and so on. We also have body control, which includes the ECU that controls the door lock, client control, seat control, etc. Then there's the chassis, a set of ECUs connected with FlexRay. This is called the chassis, and it is essentially the body of the car. For example, steer-by-wire and brake-by-wire systems. Of course, all of them are connected to the diagnostic, which is the onboard diagnostic port. This port is used to connect so a technician can view car malfunctions or messages that display the car's log. These ECUs can be categorized based on their specific functionalities or broader categories within the vehicle systems. The evolution of in-vehicle network technology has seen three stages. But before diving into those stages, it's essential to understand that the current time is often referred to as the domain vehicle architecture era. This will, in the foreseeable future, transition towards the zonal vehicle architecture. So, what exactly is this domain vehicle architecture? In simpler terms, it's how a vehicle organizes or distributes its electronic control unit CU based on logical domains. A logical domain isn't something physical. For instance, while powertrain is a logical domain, it doesn't represent a tangible component, but rather a category under which various functions like braking, transmission, or engine control fall. So if we were to discuss a part of the vehicle, like the front left, that would be a physical domain. This architecture implies a communication system like the CAN bus, which consists of nodes. These ECUs on the CAN bus send and receive CAN frames or CAN FD. For clarity, imagine connecting an engine controller ECU, a transmission controller ECU, and a brake ECU wall on a CAN bus. This collective can be viewed as a logical domain named powertrain. At the end of this CAN bus, there's a gateway connecting the entire domain, enabling it to communicate externally, specifically through what's known as the service-oriented gateway. Every domain generally has its domain controller gateway, and these nodes are interconnected in a closed loop, ending with a gateway to connect them externally. The vehicle is divided into several other domains too. For instance, some ECUs handle the infotainment system, including the radio and touchscreen functionalities. Similarly, the advanced driver assistance systems have their domain. In this ADAS domain, there might be networks using CAN or Ethernet and ECUs that perform functions like traffic, sign recognition, emergency auto braking systems, and lane departure warnings. However, the vision for the future isn't just about distributing electrical control units based on these domains. Instead, it will be about organizing them according to zones. This means dividing the vehicle based on physical locations. For example, there will be zones like front left, front right, rear left, and rear right. We won't distribute based on logical domains, but rather on physical location. What exactly is AES and zones? It's an internal network like CAN connected in such a way that for me, it is a zone. In this setup, a single ECU in the zone acts as a gateway to the outside world. This gateway electrical control unit connects both within the zone's closed network and outside it. Creating zones based on physical location has benefits related to the vehicle's wiring. Using zones can reduce the number of cables and their length in the vehicle. Vias that serve a particular section of the car are placed close to each other. Before, green wires connected only to similar green wires. But now, using zones, they're combined in a separate network, like the powertrain. Internal networks, or zones, are now based solely on the physical location in the car. So to summarize this lead, in modern in-vehicle networking, the distribution focus has shifted from logical domains to physical locations termed as zones. These zones are essentially internal networks, with CAN being a prime example. Within these zones, a solitary electronic control unit CU takes on the role of a gateway, bridging the internal closed network of the zone and the outside world. The transformation to this zone-centric model emerged mainly due to the intricate wiring systems of vehicles. By establishing zones based on physical locations, it becomes possible to minimize the quantity and length of cables used, ensuring that wires servicing a specific car segment are closely positioned. Previously, connections were determined by wire type, with like connecting to like. Yet, the current system merges them under distinct networks like the powertrain. Thus, the entirety of the vehicle's internal networking is now streamlined, focusing solely on the car's physical structure, promoting efficiency and reducing complexity. I'm trying to explain that cars used to have their ECUs without any specific domain. In the past, vehicles were designed as distributed systems without any particular domain. Look at the car on the left. It might have had three CANBUSes connected through a gateway or perhaps Ethernet, CAN, LIN, all connected with a gateway to allow communication. The internal network contained ECUs distributed based on what? Nothing specific, they were just distributed. Then we shifted to a domain-centralized architecture, exemplified by the middle car. In this system, the domain dictates the distribution, creating an internal network, like the green one, with ECUs for specific tasks. But for functions related to the powertrain, I'd place them in an internal powertrain network within the car, connected through a single gateway. What exactly is this gateway? Most gateways are essentially ECUs, whose job is to transition, for example, from a CAN connected to an internal network to an Ethernet with its own network. This gateway ECU perform mapping and you define the frames. In the car in the middle, I now have a set of interconnected ECUs. Initially, all were exposed to the outside world, but now they connect through an ECU which acts as a gateway between inside and outside. Currently in the industry, you don't have to program the gateway ECU yourself. There are readily available gateways with user-friendly programming. So why should we base everything on a domain like powertrain? For instance, the light blue ECUX as a gateway for the powertrain domain, connecting all powertrain components via the CAN. You, as a gateway, connect to them via CAN, but only certain functions are exposed to the outside world, perhaps for diagnostic purposes or cloud connectivity for updates like OTA. If you send a log to a car as a diagnostic message via over-the-air software, it asks how the car is performing. This approach, focusing on the domain centralized, spanned from 2021 to 2025. The internal network does not see the diagnostics or the external world. This network communicates with each other and uses an ECU to act as a gateway. Certain information is mapped to the external protocol by the developer. The future vision introduces the Zonal architecture, which supports automotive Ethernet as a backbone. This creates zones in vehicles with multiple ECUs. These zones can have different functionalities, and the connection between them is faster with automotive Ethernet. There might be similar zones on the left and right, both front and rear of the vehicle. Each zone is controlled by a set of ECUs. These zones can contain simpler ECUs connected to cameras or more complex systems. All zones send their camera frames to a high-performance ECU in the center. This central HEU might consist of multiple system-on-chip SoC components. In SoCs, you could have multiple clusters, and each cluster can have several cores. This setup results in a significant number of cores, enabling the central ECU to process vast amounts of data. The central ECU processes the data and sends the necessary actions to each zone. This example is just a way to think about the future of automotive technology. To ensure clarity, the evolution in vehicle networks began as a distributed system without any particular structure, everything interconnected, and with a central gateway in the middle. Later on, a decision was made to segment this system. This segmentation, now evident in cars, is based on domains. Networks were created for powertrain, infotainment, ADAS, and so on. Each of these domains has its domain controller or gateway. Some data from these controllers are exposed to the external world, while other data is not. Each network's connectivity depends on its specific topology. Subsequently, the industry shifted its focus to Zonal architecture, instead of basing it on logical domains, which are centered around functionality. The division became based on the physical location within the vehicle. Inside each of these zones, there are electronic control units with varied uses. Towards the end, these zones can communicate with each other via Ethernet. Ultimately, they are connected to a high-performance central computer, which can further connect with other components. To ensure clarity, the evolution in vehicle networks began as a distributed system without any particular structure, everything interconnected, and with a central gateway in the middle. Later on, a decision was made to segment this system. This segmentation, now evident in cars, is based on domains. Networks were created for powertrain, infotainment, ADAS, and so on. Each of these domains has its domain controller or gateway. Some data from these controllers are exposed to the external world, while other data is not. Each network's connectivity depends on its specific topology. Subsequently, the industry shifted its focus to zonal architecture. Instead of basing it on logical domains, which are centered around functionality, the division became based on the physical location within the vehicle. Inside each of these zones, there are electronic control units with varied uses. Towards the end, these zones can communicate with each other via Ethernet. Ultimately, they are connected to a high-performance central computer, which can further connect with other components. The wiring harness, using the zonal architecture, now relies on the physical location within the car. So what happened? Look at this diagram to see how it's structured. Have you noticed the appearance of the wires and the difference between them and the image of the domain architecture? Because here I've made the internal network for each zone correspond to its physical location. Now, this zone contains parts of ADAS, powertrain, and another part I'm not sure of. Yes, it's okay. The old division based on the logical domain is gone, and we're moving towards this new view to reduce the wiring harness in the car. Of course, each internal zone has an ECU that acts as a gateway, converting from one protocol to the backend protocol. These zones shouldn't necessarily be interconnected or share information with each other. So now all designers are shifting to the zonal architecture in which Ethernet serves as the backbone protocol between the different zones. What does the zonal architecture do for automotive wiring. It reduces the cables and, of course, the energy and cost. The view here is Zonal. Connected with sensors, actuators, and there's a central processing unit in the middle. Of course, they say this will have multi-chip and multi-application, and this is the current trend among people, guys. We've really understood the world now and learned what the in-vehicle network means. Let's look at the CANBUS. Why is the CANBUS famous and used to connect multiple ECUs in a car? The automotive serial bus, which is the CAN, suggests that it allows multiple microcontrollers to be connected with one pair. What does one pair mean? It means just two wires connected together, which we call one pair. But there's a difference between this and the twisted pair. One of them is called CAN and the other CAN, meaning CAN high and CAN low. Also, CAN is characterized by its high speed. How fast? It reaches up to 1 MB, which is referred to in all CAN data sheet terminologies, and is the same as 1000 BPs. So often are you sending one bit? You send a bit everyone microsecond. What does that mean? It means I'm sending a million bits every second. Furthermore, CAN provides noise immunity, meaning it's resistant to noise, and we'll see why. It's also known for its low cost and prioritization of messages, meaning there can be a message with a higher priority than another.